Cyclones and hurricanes are nowhere near as dangerous nowadays. No, really. Now, I think there's a special place in hell for those who take advantage of the misery of others. And it is disappointing to see some climate scientists have a habit of taking advantage of every natural disaster to push their own barrow. Now, yes, it's legitimate for climate scientists to claim that natural events are getting worse, even though all the data suggests that far fewer people die from them than, say, 100 years ago. What was the most deadly hurricane in American history? The 1900 Galveston hurricane, at a time when the US population was way less than it is today. But okay, they can fret about climate change, but there are too many examples when the climate scientists clearly just take advantage of the publicity associated with a natural disaster. Now, when I started thinking about this video, I was going to just talk about what is, in my opinion, the disgraceful behaviour of the misnamed Climate Council. Well, in my opinion, they should be called the Arthur Daly's used car and climate doom mongers. When Cyclone Alfred was just about to crash into Brisbane the other week, guess what? They claimed that the cyclone was made worse by climate change. They just viewed the prospect of a whole bunch of flooded and smashed houses as a publicity opportunity. In my opinion, taking advantage of a bad situation, in my opinion, drooling over the happy prospect of such misery. But then I saw this video by one of my favourite YouTubers, Sabina Hosenfelder, who, unlike me, worries quite a bit about catastrophic climate change. Her video was about the disgraceful paper that came out claiming that the Los Angeles wildfires, you guessed it, were caused, at least partially, by climate change. And she comprehensively debunks that proposition using the data of these so-called scientists themselves. Check it out yourself, but let's take an excerpt.
The video I took offense with a study from the World Weather Attribution Center about the LA wildfires from January. They put out a press release which says that, quote, we find that human-induced warming from burning fossil fuels made the peak January fire weather index 30% more probable, end quote. And they also write that they have, quote, high confidence that human-induced climate change, primarily driven by the burning of fossil fuels, increased the likelihood of the devastating LA wildfires, end quote. I pointed out that their own analysis doesn't support this claim because their result is statistically insignificant. It's compatible with climate change not having had any effect on the LA wildfires from January this year. The reason I got so pissed off about this, and I tell you, my poor husband has endured me going on about this for a week now, isn't just that they didn't mention in their press release that they didn't find evidence for climate change playing a role in this fire. And it's not just that the media reported this without looking at the study results.
Now, can you guess what Sabina was cross about? It's that there must have been lots of other scientists who could see that this was a rubbish study reported right around the world, but they all kept silent. And in this case, their science was effectively corruption. But let's hear Sabina.
It's that many climate scientists know how sketchy the studies are that come out of this World Weather Attribution Center, but they keep their mouth shut. This study's been online for a month, and no one besides me noticed that the result isn't statistically significant. Seriously? I don't buy this for a second. There are many climate scientists who totally know that their so-called research isn't reliable, but they don't say a word because it'd be politically inconvenient.
And then Sabina gets quite agitated because she's seen this all before, and in fact she's had a horrible experience in her own career on this.
I've seen this happening before. It's how people in the foundations of physics destroyed the reputation of my research area. Whenever there's some crap going around in the media, they look away and keep their mouth shut, thinking all attention is better than no attention. It's one of the reasons why I don't trust scientists. I'm saying this because I really don't trust scientists. And this suspicious silence about crap studies that attract media attention is a good illustration for why.
I think she's remarkable, and although she has reported before on some of the truly dodgy work from climate scientists see this video I did on her. She's got a long way to go before she comes over to my view, which is closer to that view on Lomborg, that there may well be a small impact of humans on climate, but we're far better off trying to adapt to that change, which we can do very easily, rather than pursue the impossible dream, in fact, a nightmare of net zero. And that brings me back to the topic of today and the crossing the other week of Cyclone Alfred. Hurricanes and cyclones are now far less dangerous than they were when the world had a perfect climate. You know, despite the swings of climate over hundreds, thousands and millions of years, climate was just perfect 150 years ago when it was marginally cooler. But even when the climate was so wonderful, isn't it strange that the southeast part of Queensland had 24 cyclones and major storms between 1883 and 1898? And by far the most deadly Australian cyclone and one of the most intense cyclones in the world ever was Cyclone Mahina in 1899. But the reason that cyclones are way less dangerous nowadays is quite simple. We now have the technology and infrastructure to be able to deal with these big storms, at least to a better extent, and the relief agencies to help bail us out after they happen. So, the first reason that cyclones are not as dangerous is that we nowadays have plenty of warning that they're coming. For example, Cyclone Alfred, which just clobbered Brisbane, was being tracked for well over a week before it crossed the coast. And the Bureau now has very good models to predict where it's going to go for Alfred. The Bureau predicted that it would head off and then suddenly turn right, making a beeline for Brisbane. And that's exactly what it did. A remarkable prediction. Compared to cyclone prediction even 25 years ago, which were basically useless, we now have far better warning. But I want to go back even further to a time when there was no warning of cyclones at all. Cyclone Mahina, which I mentioned before, which crossed the coast in 1899, 400 lives lost, cyclone of prodigious proportions, a tidal surge of 3 to 5 meters high. Can you imagine if that had hit a populated area like Cairns instead of an almost uninhabited part of Cape York Peninsula? But the thing about Cyclone Mahina was that there was utterly no warning. In fact, the government meteorologist Clement Ragg worked out that there must have been a cyclone up there somewhere, but by the time he issued the warning, the cyclone had already crossed the coast and totally wiped out the Torres Strait Island pearling fleet. So for those of us who live under the shadow of the next cyclone, thank your lucky stars that we can see the storms on radar, on satellite, and the Bureau does a pretty good job at predicting where they'll go. People have a chance to prepare and get out of the low-lying or dangerous areas. Number two is that we now have far stronger buildings. This improvement has actually occurred even in my lifetime, but if we go back to, say, 1918, when my hometown of Innisfail was totally wiped out by a cyclone, it was a town of a few thousand people, but after the cyclone, there was only a dozen or so buildings left undamaged. But if you look at these pictures, it's evident that these were not buildings that were ever built to withstand a strong cyclone. And slightly shamefully, that improvement in building codes didn't really start to happen properly in Australia until Cyclone Althea smashed through Townsville in 1971. Even at that stage, it wasn't even properly understood that roofs need to be pulled down because the cyclones would just lift the roof off and that you needed what's called cyclone bolts. This was seen very clearly when Cyclone Tracy wiped out Darwin. I think wipe out is not an exaggeration. In those days, northern Australian houses were built on stumps, and it was not uncommon to see the entire top of the house blown away, leaving just the floor on the stumps. I have a mate who was in such a house in Tracy, and it's not a night that he remembers with much fondness. He and his family were forced to flee the house as it started falling apart, and then run downstairs and hid in the car for the rest of the cyclone. It was actually a very common story. Those houses just weren't built for cyclones. Nowadays, northern Australian houses are built very well. So, for example, Cyclone Yasi in 2011 was an extremely dangerous cyclone, but buildings that were built to spec suffered essentially almost no damage except for maybe falling trees and debris. Now, the final reason that we are far better off than a century ago is that when the storm has passed, we now have well-organised disaster relief organisations which help out. I can remember very well after Cyclone Larry tore through Innisfail, I had to go out there to help my parents fix their house. But I remember seeing huge convoys of trucks coming up the inland road where there was no flooding, and they were bringing generators, or seeing a convoy of electricity trucks coming all the way from Brisbane, literally 100 of them, coming back from Cairns after it was hit by Jasper in 2023. It actually brings a tear to your eye when you see the cavalry arrive like that. When Innisfail was clobbered in 1918, they were on their own. I guess it was fortunate they were tough back then, they just had to cope. But it's our duty not to think that the world is just going to end because maybe cyclones are just getting a little bit worse. And that brings me to my final point. A warming climate should give cyclones more energy available to them. A cyclone feeds off the latent heat of vaporization, and it's driven by the water vapor condensing and releasing heat to drive the central updraft. And for every 1 degree temperature rise, there's about a 7% more energy available. So a warming climate might well produce more or worse cyclones. But actually, for Australia, in fact other places, but certainly for Australia, this doesn't seem to have happened, or at least not yet. This is the graph from the CSIRO, and as they say, there's been a downward trend in the number of cyclones forming in the Australian region in recent decades, and they don't seem to be getting more severe either. So this is all rather good news. We've already adapted to cyclones too. What will we ever do with such wonderful news?